I'm Dave Barabalt, your MC for today, a voice at the Stafford Motor Speedway and the New London Waterford Speed Bowl. And when time permits, my home track in my hometown of Meriden, Connecticut, the Silver City. So at this time, we ask if everyone can please get seated and we'll get today's ceremonies underway. At this time, it's my honor to introduce the president of NEAR, Mr. Rich Goucher.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. NEAR members, honored guests. I'm Rich Goucher, NEAR president, and it gives me great pleasure to greet you here today. As a youngster, I began at Plainville Stadium watching legends like Dave Alkes, Ron Wyckoff, and Jap Membrino wow the crowds. Later on, our own brew crew owned and crewed many modified tour cars, and I ended up racing and winning with my childhood idol, Reggie Ruggiero. Now I have been honored to lead this great organization into the future. On behalf of our members, thank you all for joining us as we induct the 2022 Class of Honorees into the Hall of Fame. Every one of us here are racing enthusiasts. We were born and bred into it, were introduced into it, and got hooked. Or know someone that has dedicated their lives to it that is being honored here today. There are many clubs that race vintage cars around the speedways of New England. NEAR is the only one that dedicates itself towards preserving the rich racing history of our region and honors our standout representatives. We have a fine class of honored guests here today, and we could not be more proud of them. We thank you for your dedication to our sport. An event of this magnitude cannot be presented without the assistance of key individuals to see it through to completion. I would like to personally thank all who have had a part in producing this event. On your table, you will find a program for today's ceremony supported by a multitude of NEAR friends and sponsors and supporters. Please support those that support our efforts. We also have some remarkable collectible items available for our auction here today. Please pay them a visit if interested. Our 2022 t-shirts and other items are available as well. To the rest of our guests, I sincerely hope that you all enjoy your day. To start it off, back to Dave Barabalt.
And now please welcome to the podium, Mr. Paul Massey.
Thank you, gentlemen. The t-shirts, you know, it just struck me a little while ago as we're selling t-shirts. This is our 25th Hall of Fame induction ceremony. Unbelievable. I know some people here were here for the very beginning. I was not. I probably have been to maybe 15 or 16, but it is unbelievable. For the prayer today, it's going to be a little bit different. I've been doing this for about 45 years. I was ordained about 45 years ago, and benedictions and prayer offerings are always been part of what I have done. And it's always, for me, a privilege and an honor, as it is today. There is no doubt about it. It's something about taking full measure. And I just have a little story, and then we'll pray. When you're up there, and no matter who it is that comes to this podium, any podium, and especially when you do prayer, it's very easy for folks to take full measure. And I always appreciate comments and feedback. Well, I'm dedicating this prayer today to one of those individuals who is not a Hall of Fame member, but like myself, and as Rich has mentioned, one of these people, one of these guys that go to races and have been involved in there for a long time. But this person took full measure of me in one of my prayers. And it really changed a lot of how I present what I do and myself. So his name is Paul. And Paul passed this past summer. And his son is right here. Pete, would you stand please? Pete Newsom. So to him, Paul Newsom, and I know, he has his rightful place in heaven as I speak and as we are here today. So I'm going to ask everyone just to remain seated for this prayer. We do not have to stand. As far as I'm concerned, kneeling, standing, or sitting, everything is pretty good. So let us pray. We take full measure of what it is that we do. There's not a person in this room that has not taken full measure. If I owned a car, I would make sure that I had taken full measure of my equipment. A driver, obviously the same. Even if I were just cleaning the bolts on the wheels, I would do the best job I could. If I owned a track, or a promoter, or someone who writes about us, same thing. I know Carl Fredrickson does a great job in his article, and one again this month, on taking full measure of what racing is all about. So we pray today. We pray for all those folks who are in the military, the armed forces. They have a lot to do with the freedom that we have. We also pray for those who are first responders, not only those who work in hospitals, but police and fire. And we just know what has happened just a few days ago in Bristol, Connecticut, where two young men were shot to death in an ambush situation. And you know, talking about people who have just passed, we certainly can talk about and mention the traveling man, who also has got his place in heaven. So, we pray that God will bless us as we travel home today. Bless our conversations and old relationships that have just been rekindled. We ask him to bless those who serve us and those who have prepared our meal. And so we pray all of this in the name of our Lord and Savior, in the name of Paul Newsom. Amen. Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I just want to tell you, those who had the fish are going to die.
Did you learn that from Eric?
The first award today we're going to give out is the Frank Marotta Award. This goes out to a man who's a good friend of mine. He's dedicated his life to the history of automobile racing in New England. He owns the Pro 9 Museum. He runs it. He saves every piece of literature, photos, body panels, cars that he can. Rick has always been a racer. Besides his own short career and helping with NEAR, Rick loved the history and memorabilia side of racing. Rick has been the curator of the Pro 9 Motorsports Museum in Pawtucket, Rhode Island for many years. To step inside reveals everything from historic cars to uniform trophies, pictures, everything to do with racing over the last 60 years. To think he has done this all on his own, building it from the donations of others through the years is amazing. We just had it earlier this month. We had the Westboro reunion. We were able to raise a substantial amount of money for Rick. And it was deeply, deeply, deeply felt how much he needed it. Rick has done this with the help of his partner, R.A. Sylvia, another Hall of Famer. And two of them are the driving force of the Pro 9 Museum. So it's with great honor I present Rick with the Frank Marotta Award.
Thank you, everyone. In memory of my good friend, Gooden you. I think you know who I'm talking about, our good friend Val Lasseur. Congratulations to everyone that's being inducted today. It's an honor and a privilege for me to be amongst you again. This award has meant a lot to me since I joined the club in 1983. I've been to every banquet, every meeting, and when we decided to start the Pro 9 Motorsports Museum, it was just to house cars that were sitting behind barns and garages and things like that. I do not buy cars or artifacts. I want you to know if you come visit the museum, everything there has been gifted. We honor everybody and we display everything for all to see and remember. And that goes for all the Hall of Famers that are here today. Everything is there. It's not in boxes. It's all displayed. And I get calls every week. Do you think you want this? Of course I do. No matter what it is, we have it. So I hope someday you'll all find the time. We are seasonal. We're in a 122-year-old building, and I can't afford the heat anymore, so we're only open from like April until Thanksgiving. But the way the weather's changing, the seasons and everything, if we do have some warm days coming up, give me a call. I'll be happy to open the doors. Thank you again to the club and the members for presenting me with this award. I can't tell you how much it means to me after all these years since I started racing in 1970. Thank you. Enjoy your day.
The next award is the Mitchell Rarada Award. And this is going to be going to Carl Fredrickson. And Carl is an amazing guy. He's kept print magazine going in racing, which is unheard of today with the internet. Carl Frederick has earned a living as a professional auto racing journalist for over 30 years. Starting as a non-salary contributor, his work was so good, Carl was elevated to paid full-time writer and photographer at Stock Car Racing and Open Wheel Magazine. In 1999, the magazine was sold and the entire staff of what, at that time, was the most successful auto racing magazine in the country was all let go. Sounds familiar today, doesn't it, folks? Carl wasn't about to give up being an auto racing journalist. With Carl's help, in an effort to launch new auto racing magazine found success. Months after Stock Car and Open Wheel were sold, and Carl was hired at the new Speedway Illustrated magazine, where he went on to become its editor. The magazine was eventually sold to a Kansas firm that made dramatic personnel cuts, eventually leading to the magazine's closure. Again, Fredrickson would not give up, refused to give up. He sought and successfully secured funding to buy the Speedway Illustrated out of bankruptcy, and for the last 12 years, he has run it as publisher and lead writer. Carl and his wife, Christine, along with their two daughters, are the driving force behind one of the only auto racing magazines left to survive in the world that doesn't read anything longer than a tweet. Carl's writing and photography have earned first place honors in many journalism competitions. His magazine supports the fans and those who participate in it. He is nationally recognized for playing a major role in promoting the popularity of local level auto racing. Carl is a solid tell it like it is writer whose monthly magazines help racers go faster and race more safely with spending less. So at this time, please bring up Carl Fredrickson for the Mitchell Rarada Award.
Well, thank you, Mark. That's is all pretty overwhelming. My name is Carl Fredrickson. I'm with Speedway Illustrated Magazine. There are some copies outside. I hope you'll grab one. I'm Scottish, so to give something away is really saying a lot. But before I talk about how awesome I am, and I'm going to be brief, I want to make note of how fortunate we are in this region to have NEAR. I go around the country a lot, and there are distressingly few organizations like this one. And I challenge each of us to motivate the next generation, because we need more Nick Titos. I'm here as a writer, but I think maybe a few of you also know that I race cars too. And one of the first times I unloaded a race car, I was trying to look cool and tough and be one of the guys, and I said, well, who's a fast guy? And they pointed to this yellow number one JR precast car, and I said, Dick Houlihan. I said, Houlihan, huh? I said, yeah, but we don't call him Houlihan. You don't? What do you call him? I said, kidney stones. Kidney stones? He says, yeah, you might pass them, but it's going to hurt when you do. Since I'm not clever enough to come up with that, I got a Richard Hennessy from Hudson Speedway. I heard him say that, and I've got more miles out of that joke than Russ Conway got out of rolling the R in Russ Conway. But I owe a lot to Russ because he owned Hudson Speedway along with Charlie Smith and Ken Smith and Charlie Elliott, and that's where I fell in love with the sport. I couldn't believe that these guys like Gigi Gravel and Paul Richardson, who would soon be my heroes, were roaring around at a track that was almost in my backyard. And I had heard of NASCAR and Winston Cup primarily through reading Stock Car Racing magazine, but I had Hudson on Sunday evening and nothing was better than to be there. So, but in August of 1992, I decided to swing for the fences and write Dick Bergen a letter. And I wanted to ask him for a job. And so I reached out to a friend of mine, a pretty smart guy. And I said, he said, what do you want to do? I said, I don't care, I'll scrape the dumpster. And he said, no, find something that you can provide that the magazine is missing. I said, well, the tech stories go over my head. So I'd like to write tech stories for dumb people like me. I'm still doing it. But I wrote that letter to Dick, and he called me right away. And he said, I would get a desk and a computer, but no guarantee of a job. And he said, you do know how to use a computer, don't you? Yes, I said. It's Dick, that's the only time I've lied to you. But I figured it out, because I figured I'm on my own dime, and I'll just pay my dues. So I was an in-house freelancer for 15 months. And sometimes those months I got paid $100. I brown bagged my lunch. I plugged a tire rather than replace it on the Ford Escort that I had stolen, borrowed, got. But I learned the craft of being a writer. I wanted to make myself valuable. So I learned how to write, I learned how to take pictures, and I learned how to develop black and white prints because I wanted to become an employee. I also learned what it means to be a journalist, and it's a title I hold in really high esteem. I'm simply appalled by what it's become in the mainstream media, but I'm not going to bitch about them right now. I'm just staying on auto racing. But for me, no one, in racing or out, had a better support structure to learn motorsports media and what it means to be a journalist. I had Dick Bergen, the finest journalist the sport has ever known. I had Bones Borsier, the finest writer the sport has ever known. I had Rob Snedden, the sport's finest editor and a damn good writer as well. And I had Doug Gore. So as a budding tech writer, I had a guy with 3 degrees in engineering and 1 in physics to be my guide. Nobody had it better than me. I even had Robin Hartford, whose enthusiasm was unparalleled. And I had Lou Boyd, whose consult I rely on even to this day. So just before Christmas, Dick offered me a job, and he said, you know, you won't get rich doing this, but if experiences mean something to you, you'll be richly rewarded. Well, Bergie got that one right, too. I've driven every kind of race car except for a dirt late model. I've been to races from Seattle to Phoenix to Florida and everywhere in between. And there's been experiences away from racing as well. I've had Tony Stewart drive my race car at Star. We went head-to-head to see who'd be faster. I've been in the backseat of the number 7 jet and gone for an hour-long flight with the Blue Angels. I've flown in the front seat of Carl Edwards' plane. I've developed a friendship with John Schneider, who played Bo in the Dukes of Hazzard. I spent quality time with Bobby Orr, Adam Sandler, Stephen Perry, Kurt Schilling, and even Elvis Presley's stepbrother, Billy Stanley, who took my wife and me on a tour of Graceland. So it's all because I wrote to Dick. And it's all because Dick called me. So no matter what brought you here today, someone smiled upon you like Dick did to me. And I'd like to ask each of us to maybe just take a moment of silence and think of those people in your life who've been a good influence to you. Thank you very much.
The next award is going to this gentleman. He's always at the racetrack taking pictures. He's an amazing human encyclopedia. And he's with us today, Nick Tito. Anything you want to know about Westboro, Thompson, Stafford, whatever, he has it off the top of his head. He's an amazing individual. And Nick, would you come up here?
Hello, everyone. Glad to have this perspective for a change. First, thank you to President Goucher and Mark for the award. And Charlie Stebbins was the former rights director at Waterford, worked in public relations, and was ultimately one of NEAR's earliest supporters. So that says a lot for me. I like preserving motorsports history, and I like just really investing my time into honoring those that have made days like this possible. So it just means a lot for me to have something associated with him. Working with NEAR over the years has been very gratifying in a number of different capacities, secretary, video, photos, kind of anything they need to do, I'm willing to try and volunteer my time and help them. It's been great racing, recording and photographing, as he alluded to. That's been what feels like the last 20-something years of my life. I've always considered this event, though, a highlight every year, getting to learn more information, getting to hear new stories from each induction ceremony. It's just been wonderful. History preservation's been a goal of mine, saving all those records from various bygone tracks and trying to compile champions and winners, and even just getting to interview, I just in awe of like Dave Humphrey. Just very cool for just a kid from Johnston, Rhode Island to get an opportunity to do something like that. And it's been a fun pastime working with people from other countries, even locating old racetracks. So it's kind of fun how the collaboration and interest spans a lot farther than you could ever imagine. Congratulations to all those years inductees. And I just wanted to take a moment to thank some people that have meant a lot to me. First, thank God, especially thank my family. They've been so supportive for my whole life, of course. Jay Ackley, who gave me my start in having a chance to do anything with motorsports coverage many years ago. Russ Dowd, the longtime announcer at Thompson Speedway, has been a dear friend and a great person in this sport for many, many years. Steve Kennedy, excellent photographer and just very dedicated to this sport for decades, and glad to call him a friend. Former President Paul Massey, looking forward to our lunches. We normally have about once a month, and he's just been a good friend to my life in recent years, and great discussions. R.A. Sylvia, it's been said without him, there isn't the NEAR Hall of Fame. And it feels like half my life has been spent in his basement over the years, working through all of his archives of stuff. Anytime I needed something, he had it. I mean, so anything that is credited to me, R.A.'s the man when it comes to history, and really the person I look to guide me through a lot of these endeavors. Justin St. Louis has been excellent for this sport as well, working with Devil's Bowl primarily, but anything I need from Northern New England, he's been a huge help for a similar role with racing preservation. Matt Weirnes has been a dear friend for a long time. He's done a lot of racing coverage for us as well. And of course, Pete Zanardi, the long-term writer in Hartford, and then also did work with Stafford and Waterford over the years. He's just been a great asset to this sport as well. So thank you for your time and enjoy your day.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Pete Newsham, and once again, it's my privilege to give out the Danny Pardee Award, which is given out to a person who has dedicated so much to this, the Hall of Fame. For most of you in the audience, you know who Danny Pardee was. He was a major presence in auto racing, race director, historian, board member with NEAR, treasure with NEAR, but more importantly, when the Hall of Fame started with people like Al Feeney, Pete Zanardi, and others, he was the backbone of getting a hall just like we're sitting here today. He was so dedicated to the sport. When his passing, we decided to come up with an award to give to someone who was very, it takes everything that Danny was. It was just such dedication. And this year's recipient is, well, a lifelong race car enthusiast, car owner. When he came onto the scene with NEAR, he jumped right in. First few Hall of Fames he was in attendance with, he did the seating and was so dedicated that in later years worked his way up through the ranks and became the club president. His dedication is amazing, but along the way, NEAR has gone through some changes. There's been changes of meeting locations, membership started to have a slump, and then we got hit with the big one, the pandemic. That took a lot to overcome, but this person persevered, got all of us people together on the board, Mark Alden, April May, everybody involved, works with all the committees, with the truck committee and everything. So it's not just near Hall of Fame, it's near in general. So it is my honor to present the dedication award, the Danny Pardee Award for dedication to the Near Hall of Fame to the President, Rich Goucher.
I would like to thank Near for recognizing me with the Danny Pardee Award. Those of you that knew Danny, they remember he was a very matter-of-fact, direct, to-the-point kind of guy. He was a bit rough around the edges, but with a gigantic heart and love for all in the racing community. He was a true guiding force within our club, and he's dearly missed. I'm pretty comfortable helping just about anybody with anything, but I'm not real cozy when receiving an individual honor. As someone overseeing a large event or organization, you're duly responsible for everything that occurs. You want it all to go perfect, everyone to be happy, but that's seldom the case. Tough decisions need to be made, many on the fly as they arise. A leader's only as good as the people around them who facilitate all the individual moving parts. In that matter, I'm truly blessed. Near has a fine core group of individuals that are all talented in many diverse ways. As a team, we interact almost flawlessly in performing our individual tasks toward the desired goal. I thank each and every one of you for your time and dedication. Congratulations to each of you honored here today. You've worked very hard to make our sport successful and exciting. Near and its president are very proud of you.
The next award is the Ron Bouchard Award, and I'd like to have Paula Bouchard and Eddie Flemke to please come up.
Good afternoon. It's great to see so many friends here for another Near Hall of Fame induction dinner. On behalf of Ronnie's family and my family, I'd like to extend our congratulations to this year's inductees and their families. I'm sure this day will become a memory you'll cherish for years to come. The Ron Bouchard Memorial Award honors lifetime achievement in auto racing in New England. Most of the past recipients were names you knew very well. This year's recipient may not be familiar to you right now, but the work he has quietly been doing for many years is helping to build the future of the sport in this region. Anyone who knew Ronnie will remember that he always had time for people. He went out of his way to make time for young fans, and he was also happy to pass along advice to aspiring drivers. My father, Ed Flemke, took a similar satisfaction from serving as a mentor to young drivers and young crewmen as they made their way into the sport. My brother Eddie still spends his weekends at racetracks in this area, always offering a hand to drivers and teams who are still learning the ropes. With those three men as an example, I thought we'd honor someone in the sport who is also paying it forward, so to speak, someone doing all he can to make racing more accessible, not only today, but next year and for years to come. And that truly is a lifetime achievement. Every generation likes to think that they lived through the very best years in racing. I know many of us in this room share that feeling. But it's worth remembering that future generations of racers and fans deserve a chance to feel that same way. With that in mind, I'd like to ask my brother Eddie to say a few words about our honoree.
Well, good afternoon. On my way here, I got two things I learned today. Don't trust navigation because it sent me to Westfield instead of Westford with an hour and 40 minutes the other direction. But I made it back, thanks God, with the racing experience. I was able to get here fairly on time. And the other I learned that when you print out stuff on your printer, it's water-soluble ink, and my speech got ruined as I was making an illegal U-turn trying to get back to the right direction when my Gatorade spilled on it. So I had to go back to the written speech, so forgive me if it's a little choppy. But anyway, first of all, I'd like to thank my sister for the kind words and introduction here. Some might wonder why the adjustment to Ronnie's award. Well, it started last year at this banquet as my sister and I were enjoying the event. We couldn't help notice the change in attendance. Our group had dwindled down quite noticeably, maybe partially because of the COVID situation or maybe from all of the other life changes. But for us, we noticed one very obvious situation. None of us were getting any younger. And that led us to thinking about how we could bring some youth to our group. We talked a few times about some of the ideas we had, and the one idea we liked most was changing up the Ron Bouchard Lifetime Award to include the outstanding youth in and around our sport. So here we are. Why this young man? I knew instantly who deserved this honor. About 15 years ago, I was asked to help present trophies and awards at an annual Silver City Quarter Midget Banquet. This young man gave an amazing speech to the kids. I was impressed by his positive but quiet personality. The kids loved him, and he drew them to him. Because he was a big kid in heart or because of his size, everyone loved him, and he drew me in too. An instant friendship came from that first meeting. We became great friends over the years. Like all great friendships, we watched over each other, helping each other whenever we could. I could go on forever filling you in all of his dreams, accomplishments, and his growth becoming the fine young man he is today, but I'll let him have that honor. Besides, I'm sure you all will be hearing a lot more great things from him in the future. So again, why this young man? Being so young, I'm sure he has never met Ronnie or even saw him race in person. But if you spend some time around him, you will find the two of them are quite the same. Both have a way of bringing out the best in you if you take the time to listen to what they are teaching. If Ronnie wanted something done, he had a way to gather help around him, and it was done without even asking you. Sorry. Okay, come on. Ronnie had a way to draw you in and want you to do your best, not just for him, but for yourself. I see this in this young man. He's not quite as outgoing as Ronnie was, but he has his own way of drawing you in and pulling the best out of you. Ronnie did this for me and many others thousands of times over the years, and I know this young man will pay this honor forward to anyone that seeks his guidance. I know he will do whatever he can to help guide his students to be the best they can be in whatever they choose to do in life. He's proven this already. He's the type of guy that is often said would give his right arm to help his friends or students, and I have proof. He's already given up part of one of his fingers for one of his students. Sorry, I had to say it. Anyway, I'm honored at this time. I want to say, first of all, if you ever have an opportunity to pay something forward, do it. I'm honored and thrilled to present this year's Ron Bouchard Lifetime Award to, and I'm sure Ronnie would love this, to Mr. Johnny Margello.
All right, just a quick disclaimer. I only speak in front of people once a year at my annual banquet, and I usually just have to break the ice by saying I'm not the best public speaker, but I'm a decent reader, so don't expect me to look up from this paper. Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to thank you, Paula, and Edward for honoring me with the Ron Bouchard Memorial Award. More importantly, I appreciate you for recognizing the positive impact of our Region 1 Quarter Midget Driver Development Program. To be here in the same room with so many legends of short track racing is truly amazing. As for me, I haven't done much as a racer, and that's okay. It's what this sport has done for me that I'm most appreciative of. I started racing quarter midgets at Silver City in Meriden, Connecticut in 1996. I was 7 years old and the sport quickly became part of my signature. I'm sure all of you can recall a time in your life where you met someone new and had to share something about yourself. In these instances, I was always proud to share that I drove race cars. It was my superpower as a kid, and it helped me through some hard times. Today, more kids need to be raised knowing that they have a superpower. They all need to be able to learn, work hard, enjoy some success, and take pride in their accomplishments. Home life for me wasn't easy. Both of my parents worked around the clock, and my relationship with my dad wasn't the best. Growing up, we always ate dinner as a family, and on the weekends, we went racing. Our racing experience brought us much closer together, even more so than mom's sauce and meatballs. I had a great quarter midget career. Over a 9-year period, there were track records, track championships, hell, I even took down 5 national titles. That's 2 more than Doug Kobe. All joking aside, it took a while for me to recognize that it wasn't the accolades that made racing so special to me. It was the lifetime friendships that were made and treasured memories of happy family times. The next step for me after quarter midgets was 270 sprint dirt racing. It was a new challenge and I loved it. The winning mindset that I had developed proved to be useful as I was winning races during my rookie season. Unfortunately, while I was climbing the ladder on the dirt scene, life at home wasn't getting any better. When I graduated high school, I left home, and when I did, we stopped racing. In the blink of an eye, part of my signature was gone. For the first time in my life, I had nothing to keep me grounded, nothing to work towards, no goals. I was lost and going down a dark path. I remember being home one Sunday and back with my family. We were at the dinner table when my sister randomly broke down. It turned out that we shared the same struggle. We both wanted to go back racing. We desperately needed to fill that missing void in our lives. We agreed as a family to get back in the saddle. Nicole went modified racing, and I got myself a death trap of a limited late model. At the time, I was only interested in racing on my own terms. Although it was the ultimate struggle, it was the best decision I could have made for myself. In fact, that's what ultimately led me to Ed Flemke Jr. Eddie knew my backstory, and I'm not sure that he realizes how much I needed him to pop into my life when he did. Everything happens for a reason, and I mean everything. I started with a car that I thought would be awesome, but it turned out to be just a Flintstone Flyer. The amount of work that car needed helped put me back on the straight and narrow under Eddie's watchful eye. If Ed was at the shop, so was I, even after my car was finished. One of my fondest memories is of Eddie teaching me how to TIG weld. I would park my at his welder for hours and weld every piece of scrap steel in that shop together. When I'd drop a nice bead, I'd run it over to him like a little kid. Ed, I hope you know how much your friendship means to me. In so many ways, you saved me, and I'm eternally grateful. You're an awesome mentor. After some time, I started a business teaching kids gymnastics. It's grown a lot, and it has been very successful. My sister got married, had kids, and before long, wanted them to go racing. Silver City's program had slumped a bit with low car counts. Nicole wanted to race there, so we set out to revitalize the program. After enlisting some help with some alumni, the driver development program was born. Since 2019, the program has put over 100 race-ready cars on the track for entry-level families to begin their racing experience. Families can affordably rent a car with full support services in order to gauge their kids' interest. The program helps folks locate their own first cars after the first year should they want to continue. Car counts are now off the charts in every class. The most important things, more kids are getting the chance to be a superhero. Families are growing closer by sharing a common interest. Every race team in our pits have grown together to be one big family. Each year, the family gets bigger. I'd like to thank all our sponsors, vendors, volunteers, everyone who has had a hand in this journey. I'd like to congratulate Carl Fredrickson of Speedway Illustrated for receiving his media award here today. His magazine will feature our program in an upcoming issue, and we could not appreciate it more. Racing folks helping racing folks, what a concept. Congratulations as well to all others honored here today. You are our heroes. Thank you.
That concludes our awards portion of today's ceremony, and now it's time to begin our Veterans Committee inductions. Living in Central Connecticut, I would go to Plainville Stadium and see my hero, Billy Greco, race on Sunday afternoons after a Saturday night at Riverside. Long before there was Ted Christopher, there was this gentleman who would come out of the pits, and quite simply at Plainville, you either cheered or you booed. There was no middle ground. But you paid your money to see what he was going to do. So here to induct into the New England Antique Auto Racers Hall of Fame is his grandson, an accomplished driver in his own right, and who next year, in May, is going to go on the wildest ride in his life as he brings two daughters into the world. Please welcome Mr. Tony Membrino to induct Tony Jeff Membrino.
Thanks, Dave. Had to throw that in there. I'm going to try to do a little better than John, and I'm going to try to actually make some eye contact, but no promises. That was really cool to follow up that act. John and I have been friends for 20-something years now, and my stepson has been a part of John's driver development program. It's, like you said, everything happens for a reason. It's really cool to kind of be able to share this moment with him. But on to Jap. You know, when it comes to recognizing and honoring someone in any form of sports, a lot of people like to resort to stats and numbers and data and things like that. And it's easy. You know, some of the family were saying, oh, don't forget to talk about how he won 9 straight races and 12 on the year. And yeah, cool, great. But like Dave just led to, there's more to Jap than that. And that's what I wanted to touch on today. And I didn't want to like go on and rattle on about what he did here and what he did here. I kind of wanted to kind of give the Sunday dinner table discussions, as we'll like to call it. And you know, I'll be blunt with all of you. The language might get a little colorful, but I'll keep it kosher. But what I really wanted to touch on is Jap's legacy. And it's more than winning races and championships and accolades. And I feel like his legacy can be laid out into 3 layers. The first I could sum up into 3 words: purple 00. Purple race cars weren't really a thing back then. Truth be told, they're really not a thing now. Same can be said with 00 slapped on a race car. But I can tell you right now that at some point in time, either of those two or a combination became synonymous with Jap and the name Membrino. And you can bet on it, if you see a purple race car at a short track in Connecticut or somewhere in New England, probably Connecticut, but I guarantee you that at least one person in attendance will see that car and their brain will associate with the name Membrino. And that's because of Jap. Same thing with 00s. I mean, there's a modified racing around Stafford every single week that's been fabricated, painted, and lettered as a tribute to him. And no relation to us, so that those bets are off. But that just, for a guy that hasn't been in a race car officially since the 70s, that's really saying something special. The second layer of Jap's legacy is his reputation. And like Dave alluded to, the either cheering or booing. You know, it's no it's no coincidence that, you know, when Mike Joy will tell you this, before Jimmy Spencer had the name Mr. Excitement, that name belonged to Jap. And on the track, he was a fierce competitor, fast, fearless, and elbows out. Myself, being born in 1989, I never got to see him race. So when I started racing quarter midgets, he'd always tell me not to be afraid to race on the outside. Anyone that's seen a quarter midget race knows that that's a rarity, and if it is, it's short-lived. So I'd be like, okay, yeah, whatever you say. Until one day, probably I was in my 20s, and someone was like, hey, we're at his house for one Sunday dinner, and said, hey, we're gonna go downstairs and watch a video of your grandfather racing. Huge surprise they had videos back then. And it was in color, do you believe that? But it was at Plainville, relatively flat. I had never really seen it before, and he started in the back. It was a heater, a feature, whatever, and I couldn't believe it. The old fart rode around the outside of everybody and blew their doors off. And I never looked at him the same way since then. Just a lot of admiration, and he gave me that grin, like, see, I told you I could do it. And when I started driving at the big tracks myself, I found my gall, I found my nerve, and I started driving around the outside. And, you know, I'd call him on the way home, or he'd call me, or the next day, and I would tell him what happened, and he'd be like, oh, that a boy, drive around the outside, lean on him. He said that too, lean on him. And I knew what he meant. And then one day, at one of the Plainville Stadium reunions at the Berlin Fairgrounds, someone decided to slap us two in some flat carts, and he showed me what he meant by that. Thinking I'm being nice, I had the weight advantage on him, so I'll start on the outside. We didn't make one corner. He took me straight out, straight in the wall. But that's how he was. You know, he didn't hold any quarters for anybody. And that kind of leads into the next part of his reputation. You know, we talked about on the track and his reputation off the track. Mm-hmm. That's a different story. But, you know, if I'm talking to people that are unfamiliar with racing or unfamiliar with me, and, you know, it goes like someone says, oh, what was so special about your grandfather? And, you know, the way I like to explain this part about Jap, it's a little unique, but it was simply this. If he won 100 races in his career, he won 200 fights along the way. That's why if someone says, actually, I just had this yesterday at a random storage unit. Are you related to Jap Membrino? My go-to answer is, why? Or depends. But... and truth be told, that reputation followed him, his kids, and his grandkids throughout their racing careers. It's 2022, and even now, if one of us is in a skirmish on the track, more than likely, I would say 8 times out of 10, if you look off in the distance, there might be 1 or 2 security guards just standing off in the distance. And I'm telling you, it's not because they were there or they got nothing else to do. It's for the same reason that, you know, they put warning labels on packages of cigarettes, and messing with one of us might be hazardous to your health. You know, we try to stay away from that these days. But, you know, some might call that a black cloud, bad PR. Oh, car owners won't like it, sponsors won't like it. And I've tried to take a nice little spin on that, you know, take a little more professional approach as I raced. And I like to look at it glass half full, kind of like stripes on a tiger. You see a big cat, and you see stripes on that cat, you know not to mess with it. But that's just the effect Jap had. And the last pillar of Jap's legacy is his family. Aside from his near 30-year career that started under a false name because his father wouldn't let him race, over 40 wins, championships, the biggest pillar of Jap's legacy is being the patriarch of a racing family that spans across 3 generations that saw his kid on racetracks in Connecticut over the last 70 years. To me, that's pretty freaking cool. And it's not very common that you see a racing family tradition span that far. You know, give or take, we weren't on the track for all 70 of those years, but a couple years on and off, but still racing to this day. And now that he's got 2 great grandchildren, and as Dave said, 3 more on the way, who knows how much further into the future his family's racing involvement will go. I can go on and on about my grandfather, how great he was as a driver, how great he is now. It's easy for someone like me, being his grandson, to build him up on this pedestal and say all these nice things about him. But to touch a little bit on how much farther his legacy goes beyond that, A short letter was sent to me by another championship racer that I wanted to share with you. I had to shorten it up a little bit because he rambled quite a bit. Jap, I'm sorry I couldn't be there today on your big day. I can't say enough how happy I am for you getting this type of recognition. I've been a huge fan of yours since I was 8 years old. Next to my father, you were my hero. When I started racing, I raced at tracks you raced at, trying to follow in your footsteps, and I found success. But some would say I had one problem, aggression. Go figure. When a Riverside Park official told me I drove like Jap Membrino, I said thank you and slapped Jap on my car shortly after. To me, that could not have been a better compliment. I'm proud to call you my friend and hero. You've raised a beautiful family, you have a great wife, your sons are great guys that have adapted me into their Italian family. Your grandsons have become super young men. Thank God Tony's son carried on the name, winning races and titles all over the state, because talent sure skipped a generation. Congratulations, Jap. You more than deserve this recognition. I love you and thanks for the memories. Your friend and number one fan, Larry Vassar. So that's all the time I'm gonna take up here. Jap, I'm gonna hand this off to you. Again, congratulations. All of us at those four crazy tables back there, we love you and we couldn't be more proud of you.
This is the next Hall of Famer. He won three championships in 1 year. Three of them he won. I'm not up here to tell jokes or anything because I'm not that much of a talker. I like to drive better. I'd like to thank Nir for putting me into the Hall of Fame. I just got out of the hospital. I had a stroke. So pardon me a little bit. I want to thank my crew chief, Chuck Squatriglia, and Earl Riley. Stand up. I don't know how, I want to thank my family. I don't know how they put up with me. I don't know how they put up with me because I'm not that easy to get along with, I'll tell you that now. My crew chief, I drove him crazy. That's why he's got all gray hair. Now, I want to thank a lot of people. I thank my, this is a good one. I thank my makeup lady, Pat Kelly. Where is she? Somewhere here. I want to thank her. You know, I've done a lot of racing. I raced, matter of fact, I raced the Lebanon Valley. I raced every track around. And I tried to do good, but all right, did pretty good. Kenny, I was his idol. He was my favorite driver. Oh boy, I don't know. I don't really have much to say. I don't know what else to say. What do you want me to say? I don't know. I tell you, I thank all my friends. All my friends that came to see me here. Thank you.
Yeah, we're good.
Rich too. My right friend
here.
Rich.
Right here.
Yeah. And Paula. Richie and Paula.
Love you, man.
Thank you. You know, I wanna thank Eddie Flimke, Paula, and Kenny Bouchard for coming to see me. I raced with Kenny. My daughter's here.
Your granddaughter?
I don't know. Oh, wait a minute. Wait a minute. I got a good one for you. There's a young lady. She better stand up when I point this thing out, too. Samantha Anderson Membrino. Stand up. young girl just won the heat, the main at New London, and beat all the guys, kicked their butt. She's another one that's gonna be up here, you watch. Mark my words, she's gonna be up here. Look at this over here. My daughter-in-law, my future niece. I thank everybody, honest. I got much to say, especially Rich. I waited a long time to get into here.
Thanks for all the years.
Long time.
Thanks for all the years.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for.
To introduce our next inductee to the Hall of Fame, when I first started at the New London Waterford Speed Bowl, his blog was what you had to read on Monday morning. This was long before he started his video career, to find out what happened and give his take on that Saturday night's racing. That has grown into videos. There's a 6-part video on the history of the Speed Bowl. He's done videos on Richie Evans and some of the other heroes of the bowl. And coming up, he has a video online about the late Fred DeSaro, who was one of my heroes, and the Whip City Speedway. So to introduce our next Hall of Famer, please welcome to the podium, Tom Sid DiMaggio. And if you've ever watched his videos, maybe he'll even give us a few hi-yahs to get through today's induction. Please welcome Tom Sid DiMaggio.
Hi, everybody. I can promise you I'll look up a little bit more than Johnny, much less than Tony, and I won't be nearly as entertaining as Jap. But I'm going to tell you a little about Charlie Webster. He was truly an icon in the Speed Bowl's first 2 decades. He started in the first season, actually, and won his first race in 1951. In the mid-50s, he teamed up with Billy Simons, and he drove the Excavator Special to 3 championships in 4 years, 1956, 58, 59. With that last one, he became the Speed Bowl's first 3-time champion. He moved to the Modifieds in the 1960s, where he teamed up with Freddie Beaver and drove the Checkerboard 716, a version of which you can still see around the tracks today with the near guys. He drove that car from 61 to 68, won 29 races, and nobody won more modified races during that span at the Speed Bowl than Charlie did in that car, including winning the 1966 modified title, his 4th championship at the Speed Bowl. In 1969, he drove for my uncle, Dick Brooks, won 4 races driving the 65 car. And then in 1970, pretty interesting end to Charlie's career. At the opener of 1970 at the Speed Bowl, Don Collins, who was the defending champ and driving that Excavator Special car, finished 2nd in the opening race and decided he was done, retired on the spot. During that same race, my uncle had a cash offer from a guy from Long Island and said, "I'll buy your race, your whole race operation right now." And as Brooksy told me, it was an offer that he couldn't refuse. And so Charlie was without a ride. And that opened up the opportunity to reunite with Billy Simons. And he joined the Excavator Special number 9 car again and won his last 2 races before he decided in the middle of 1970 that he too was going to retire. When he did, Don Collins, I should say, had more wins or championships than Charlie. He will forever be the all-time leader in non-Ford victories at the Speed Bowl. And his 77 wins, some 50-something years after he last raced, is still 7th on the all-time list at the Speed Bowl. After Charlie finished racing, he stayed involved at the track as a sponsor, took out ads in the program, supplied the pace car for many years. We sadly lost Charlie in 1995, at which time his son Eric was racing at the bowl. Eric made a few trips to Victory Lane before back problems forced him to retire. He immediately became an official, which he still is today. So it's safe to say that the Webster family has been associated with the Speed Bowl for its entire 73-year history. Webby and I have become good friends over the years, and it is truly my honor, Eric, to say that your father, Charlie Webster, is where he rightfully belongs in the Near Hall of Fame.
How y'all doing? Some of you, especially in the back, might not like me too much today. Sammy, how you doing? Great job, by the way. Zap, congratulations. Congratulations to all the inductees. I was only 8 years old when he finished up, and all I know is a lot of pictures and trophies that hang around the house and a lot from the historians of the sport, you know, Pete Zanardi and Sid and all the good writers of the sport. And I just want to say thank you to the Hall, thank you to everyone, thank you.
Before we move on with our inductions, I'd just like to remind everybody that at the end of all of our inductions, we'd like to have all of our award winners and our Hall of Famers to come up and take a group photo. So please keep that in mind when we conclude today's program. I'm going to try to do this one, looking out at everyone and try not to look down. Quite simply, I would not be here talking to all of you if it weren't for two men who gave a 45-year-old guy a shot to try to announce. One is Hall of Famer Ben Dodge. The other is our next inductee. In about July of 2005, he asked if I wanted to come down to the Speed Bowl and finish out a few events. I did, and since March of 2006, we have been regular voices at the New London Waterford Speed Bowl, longer than Tom and Giselle have been together. The only thing, we're both not as rich and not as handsome. I threw to him at the tower at the Stafford Motor Speedway, both he and Ben, and I said, well, Hall of Famer in Ben Dodge and a future Hall of Famer. It's time to take the adjective of future off. To tell us more about a man who can make the top six cars fit inside a donut hole, the Lee has shrunk to the size of a $5 footlong, or you can be close enough to do chin-ups on the back bumper. He's a racer himself, a historian, and has his own nickname from Matt Butler, the cruiser, Carl Olberg.
Probably know me as a sucker right now, right? Well, I'm Carl Olberg, but honestly, no one knows Carl. But in the racing world, all I get now is, hey, cruiser, hey, cruiser, hey, cruiser. And they literally don't know my name. They just say it's the cruiser, thanks to Matt. I appreciate that. But like everyone in this building, we're all addicted to racing in one way or another. You know, a lot of us have it pretty bad. As you can see, I can't refuse something like that. And even in my family with the addiction, sometimes we start the race car up in the winter just to smell the Cam 2 race gas. And with my kids, I would sign their homework. When my wife wasn't there, my daughter would say, Dad, don't do anything stupid. I go, I won't. So I'd sign it, completed by, and then I'd say, the cruiser number 47. She goes, Dad, you are so annoying. So, but I just wanted to say that everyone here are heroes to everybody, like Jeff Mandrino and Bob Poverari and Bugs and Bill Greco, Dick Houlihan. There's so many people here that we all just watched and we were in awe of. And racing's hard. And these people who make it to the Hall of Fame status are just really unbelievable. But I just want to say quickly, you know, my journey started when I was 6 years old at Stafford Speedway. My dad brought my brother, and he said, let's all pick a car, pick a car. So I was a serious little guy, and I watched the warm-ups, and I looked out, and I says, I'm taking the orange 2X. My dad said, good pick, that's Steady Eddie Funky. And I says, that's my guy. And he ended up being my hero for life. And I enjoyed watching Eddie Jr.'s career, but to this day, I still like talking about Eddie and everything that went on. And it doesn't take anything away from all the other great drivers, but I really enjoyed watching my man, Steady Eddie, do it. But It's not all about the drivers. They don't put on the show. You need everybody to put on the show, including the announcers. Now, I grew up in Westboro, Mass., and at the Westboro Speedway, we had an announcer named Al Frazier. And I gotta tell you, his voice was smooth. And that show didn't start until he said, "Welcome to the Westboro Speedway, folks. This is Al Frazier." And you know the program was starting. It was great. By the mid-70s, we would make my stepfather drive us to Stafford, because that was the heyday, okay? All the big heavy hitters started deep in the pack. They played their theme song. What was it? The theme from Shaft. Put goosebumps on it. It was crazy. And then you had the announcing team. You had Bill Welsh, Jack Yeru Jr., Hall of Famer, Mike Joy, Hall of Famer, white pants, crimson jacket, white Winston patch. They really brought it. They were just a great team. But not to be outdone, you go to Thompson Speedway, you had Russ Dowd, you know, former racer, slight guy, deep voice. He was great. And you also had Hall of Famer legend Ben Dodge. Just phenomenal. And then when the Super Modifieds came to town, True Value, you had John Spence. And once again, you said, "Boy, this guy is good." And not to be outdone, when the Mighty Midgets came to town, you had Pete Falcone. No one better than Pete. He is great to this day. He's announcing at Thompson New Hampshire Speedway as well. But as we got to be adults and, you know, we started getting into racing, a couple friends, Mark Alden, Ronnie St. Germain. But one day, Mark and I are at the races as fans and drinking a number of Wobbly Pops. And we hear Rick Flair comes out of turn four like he squeezed out of a tube of toothpaste. We go, "What the hell was that? Did we drink too many beers here? What's going down?" And at Thompson, it would be, "These three cars are so close you could put them all in a Kleenex box." But, you know, that's Matt, you know, and he is an ultra professional. He's amazing. In 2007, again, with my friend Ronnie and Mark, we decided, we're getting old, let's see if we can go race the Sunoco Modifieds at Thompson. Well, let's say we tried to race, we did the best we could. But that's when I saw the other side of Matt Buckler. You know, he would come through the pits with his pad and paper, you know, kind of walk, you know, slowly, big smile on his face. And he would ask, "How's it going? Hey, Cruiser, how you doing?" And many new sponsors. And he'd go from car to car, and, you know, that would transpire, and it was just really fun. And then, you know, our team, after we raced, we would go frequent the clubhouse to have a few more of those Coca-Colas and pizza. And usually Matt would walk in, you know, at the end of the night. And he'd walk in and say hi to people, and he'd make eye contact with him, and he'd say, "Here's the Cruiser, ladies and gentlemen. Not a winner on the track, but a winner in the clubhouse." And then we get to talking with him a little bit, and I realized, man, this guy really works hard. He's telling me, "Yep, Wednesday I'm at Waterford, Thursday I'm here at Thompson, Friday at Stafford, and Saturday back to Waterford." I said, "Jesus, how do you fit in?" He goes, "Well, I got to get going because I'm writing a story now, because this is my part-time work, my main job." He works for, I don't know what it is, the Journal Inquirer in Connecticut. And he had to write all night long because that's his main job. Racing was kind of his part-time gig. It was unbelievable. But, you know, I really said, "Boy, that guy really has racing in his veins. He is just, he's phenomenal. He's funny behind the mic, super professional, pretty smart guy, but he's not that smart. He also likes New York Jets." And in the middle of the Brady Super Bowl era, we would go back and forth. He'd say, "Cruiser, I think the Jets got him tonight." I go, "Matt, come on. You know, we're the ones drinking here. Are you sure you're not drinking something?" He's like, "Well, they're gonna beat the Patriots." I said, "Well, why don't you bet me something?" He'd say, "Hey, Cruiser, how about a steak dinner?" I go, "Sounds good." Well, you know, after they got thumped and I won my state dinner, he was dumb enough to do that bet again, doubling nothing on the next one. I said, bring it on, bud. And I still am owed 2 state dinners. I have not collected yet, man. But when you're better, let's go get one, okay? Well, I gotta say, I am so proud of Matt. He is a hard, hard, hard working guy. And he loves the sport. And I'm really proud of Paul, my friend. He is a Hall of Famer now, and I want to bring up Paul Massey to make it official.
Can you believe this? You're going into the Hall of Fame. Without further ado, I'd like to present you as an inductee into the NEAR Hall of Fame 2022.
I have to talk quickly. I have to talk quickly because I had the fish. Thank you, Cruiser. Actually, I wanted to give you the name of Carl the Comet, but you just weren't fast enough. I mean, nothing else I could do. I'd like to thank the committee for making this possible, especially this year. I was going through some rough times, and it was one of the worst years of my life, and it was like I was living at Camp Lejeune. And then I got the call from a Rich Goucher, and I've been in a penthouse ever since. I'd like to thank everyone with NEAR. I had a great relationship with it for many times, and have a lot of friends here, and you made my year. Thank you very much. It came at a time when I really needed it. And the added bonus to be inducted on the same day as the induction of my first idol in sports, Tony Chapman Brino, the first guy I ever idolized. The New Brick and Herald used to have on Monday the results from the weekend at Plainville Stadium. So I used to get the paper every Monday, and 1 week the headline would be Tony Chapman Brino, suspended for life at Plainville. Then the following week it would be Tony Chapman Brino wins again. So the only driver I know who led Plainville Stadium in victories and lifetime suspensions. I started covering racing in 1980. At the Journal Enquirer, where I started, we had a good race writer, Mike Adiskavage. I'm sure some of you know him. But he went to be a Southington cop, and they had nobody to cover racing. Now, usually in those days, the man who got to cover racing was the low man on the totem pole. And I was so low, the gutter was a step up, so they assigned it to me. And to make it even more frightening, the first assignment I had was to do a story on Richie Evans, who had the reputation of intimidation, but he was winning everything in sight. So I called him at his house, and I could have been more happy. What a down-to-earth, well-spoken, took maybe a half hour to talk to me, and I never forgot that, how someone at the giant of the sport could be such a down-to-earth, friendly, accommodating guy. Then I soon found out that's the way all race drivers are. I mean, I've met a lot in the 40 years I've been involved in motorsports, and they've been all great, from Ron Bouchard, who I interviewed at a place called Tommy Vanskoy Diamond Mines before a race at Pocono, and Mike Stefanik, Reggie Ruggiero. Then it went down to Ted Christopher and the current crop of drivers, like Woody Pitcat and Doug Kobe and Tony Bambrino Jr., the first time I ever saw him without sunglasses, it's today. So they've all been great guys to cover and to get along. I had some great moments. In 1983, I wasn't covering the races at Stafford. I was covering an American Legion game, put the final period on the last sentence, and we got a call on the police radio. Something happened at Stafford. So I had no idea what it was, but a photographer and myself went to Stafford to see what was going on. Didn't take me long to find out. Corky Cookman's 04 was in the bleachers. And it was kind of a chaotic scene, and I didn't know what to do. I ran into Brian Ross, and I talked to him. What happened? And he told me almost exactly what happened from his memory. The video came out the next day, and it was exactly the way he said it was. So I really owe him for helping me write that story. And because I was the only writer that night to talk to a driver, I got a $25 bonus. And I spent 50 of it the next day at the beer gardens in Riverside. Then my announcing started in the 90s. I got good training. The glory days at Stafford, I call it, the early 90s when the SK Modifieds were becoming the lead division. And they had some spectacular battles. And the two words that a race driver has never said to me was no comment. They had a comment about everything. So back then, it was a war every Friday night. And I would go back to the office, and they weren't racing fans, but they wanted to know, what did Ted Christopher say about Bo Gunning? What did Bo Gunning say about Ted Christopher? What did Mike Christopher say about Ted Christopher? Could you print what Ted Christopher said about Mike? You know, Richie Gallup, John Anderson. It was just great to be part of it. Those Friday nights at Stafford made the madhouse look like a daycare center. There were some crazy times there, and I really enjoyed it. I first started announcing at Riverside Park. Ben Dodge gave me a job announcing school bus demolition derby. And then I announced every Sunday show, which was a lot of fun. But then when Riverside decided to put in a roller coaster and take out the track, I thought my announcing career was over, that I would never get another chance. But as luck would have it, Ben Dodge, who hired me at Riverside, got a job as advisor at Thompson, and he hired me again. And that was a great association, me and Thompson Speedway. I would say the track owner, Don Honing, was one of the greatest people I have ever met in my life. I got it, you know, son, DR, was great. And the two benefits of announcing at Thompson, I got to work with a legend, Russ Stout. And we were kind of a good fire and ice combination, as Russ would be laid back and very articulate, and he had the deep voice, and me, I would be out of control. And it was a pretty good team. And the other thing I miss most about Thompson, they had the best clubhouse pizza. That Carl knows the answer to that one. Then I went to Stafford, and it kind of started at part-time, but Jack Arute, Jr. wanted to start a TV show, a cable show, and it branched out into NASCAR New England. We were on WCTX Channel 59 every Saturday night, and what I remember most about that, we got a higher rating on Saturday night than we did for IndyCar racing when they had it on Sunday afternoon. So the show was very popular. I worked with Ben Dodge, and then I work with Ricky Fuller. We take the show at Jackie's Horse Barn in Suffield, and I couldn't wait to get out of there, neither could Ricky. He was so fast, Ricky Fuller. He could do a 30-minute show in 22 minutes. He just couldn't wait to get back to his business. Now, Jackie Arute really helped me. He taught me a lot. And Ben Dodge and Jackie Arute are the two biggest influences I had in my career. As I used to ask Jackie, how do you fill time? And he goes, that's easy. Just keep talking until you have something to say. And I got to be pretty good at that. Went to Waterford. Pete Zanardi, Hall of Famer, recommended me for Waterford. And I had a great association there, and still do, with Terry Eames. Was a great owner to work for. He started a radio show, and I hosted that, Let's Talk Racing. And sometimes we didn't have a guest, and I would always be able to call two guys at the last minute, and they would always come on, Ryan Preece and Ted Christopher. And Ted, the best part of the show when we were in commercial break, and that was the stuff that was really entertaining, but nobody got to hear it except me. I was also in a movie that Terry kind of organized, and has anybody ever seen 3 Weeks to Daytona? One person. Well, that, I bought, I think, the last copy. I heard they made pretty good beer coasters. But Rip Torn was in that movie, who starred in the Larry Sanders Show. I heard he was at Waterford Speed Bowl for 2 days, but he doesn't even remember he was there. It was just something good. I played the announcer, and I don't think I screwed it up. I would also like to thank Tom Dionne for getting me involved at Pomfret, Wade Gagner for getting me involved at the Wild Thing Carts. I really enjoyed watching the kids race, and not just the kids. At Pomfret, I got to watch a guy who's going in the Hall of Fame today, Phil Rondo, and he still put on a show, as my tongue could not keep up with him. So it was a great experience at Pomfret. When you drove in, it was like you were going through the set of Deliverance, and then all of a sudden you saw the track and it turned into Shangri-La. And it was like I was announcing going on vacation. It was pretty good. But the last group of people I would like to thank, I don't know their names. I don't know who they are, but they encouraged me at the track. They would say how much they enjoyed it, what big fans they were, and that meant more to me than anything. This year, the few times I announced, I would announce from my golf cart outside, and people would come up to me and ask me how they were doing and saying it was good to have me back, and those comments meant more than anything. The fans. That's what we were in business for. Any driver today will tell you they do what they do because of the fans, and the same is true for announcers. And I just would like to thank all the people that I didn't have a chance to thank this year for encouraging me. And of course, I would like to thank all my fellow announcers, Ben Dodge, Dean Mercier, Raleigh Jacobs, the main people at Stafford, Russ Dowd, at Thompson and at Waterford, Dave Barrowball. Like you, thank you to thank you, Dave, for taking over this year when I couldn't. Of course, John Gates, Mark Fish, Gary Danko. I enjoyed working with them all. So it all started when our racing writer at the Journal Enquirer went to become a Southington cop, and it turned out not to be just the biggest break of my career, it turned out to be the biggest break in my lifetime, being involved in motorsports and motorsports people. I'd like to thank everybody for making it happen. Thank you very much.
Now, we all know in racing, the driver comes out, I get to interview them in victory lane or whatever, but there are people behind the scenes that help out. Those that don't get the credit, we just hear of them. Here to introduce one of those people is a driver who started in drag racing, has made his way into road racing, and of course, oval racing. Like, you're welcome to the stage, Mr. Bill Bernard.
First of all, I want to say thank you so much for the invitation to come down here and to introduce one of the most recognized and respected engine builders in the Northeast, Nat Chevatone. Unfortunately, Nat, at the advice of his physician, decided it best not to attend today's festivities and asked me to speak briefly on his behalf.
One of his claims to fame, because he doesn't have a lot to say to anybody. And that's a good thing. He'd like you all to know that he's extremely grateful and humbled to be honored here today for his contributions to the racing community. More so, Nat sends a big thank you for his induction into the Hall of Fame. We all know how much time and effort it takes to do what we do, and the sacrifices it takes, especially on our families and loved ones.
So I'd like to take this time to recognize his wonderful wife, Elaine, whose love and support and patience, believe me, I say that tongue-in-cheek, patience, for all those crazy hours he puts in every week to keep his teams chasing those checkered flags. So it is with the utmost respect and admiration for Nat that I'd like to have his wife, Elaine, come up to the stage and accept the award on his behalf.
You expect this. All I want to say is thank you very, very much for acknowledging my husband, Nat Shevatov. This is a big honor for him, and it's a bigger honor for me. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Our next inductee, race at the Seacon Speedway. His inductor has won pro stock championships at Thompson and Seacon, and for several years with modified tour racing. Let's welcome to the podium to induct Dick Houlihan, Robert Jr. Tate.
It should be short and sweet also.
Yeah.
All right. Good afternoon. Welcome to New England Auto Racing Hall of Fame Class of 22 inductee ceremony. This distinguished class of honorees displays the very best, some of the very best that auto racing has to offer. I can think no one better to recognize his accomplishments. For my part, I'm here to induct a driver who I have spent most of my career alongside. A loyal and talented racer, but more importantly, a dear friend, Dick. Dick and I began our careers in racing at the now closed Lakeville Speedway. I was very small then, but it was all there. But in respects, kids who were fortunate enough to discover a passion for truly unique sport. In 1987, we began a partnership along with the crew chief Dave Phillips that would return a friendship we maintain to this day. Jane Autry cast a yellow number one pro star race weekly at Seacon Thompson Lee, and we on occasion did some open racing. With the capture of the 96 track championship, we took on and open races along the way. And with wins at Thompson, Waterford, Lee, Speedways, we partnered the VAR team with Joe Veras to continue racing at Seacon. This merger resulted in top five finishes weekly, three wins, and two championships. The most notable win for me and a few of us on the team was the race after the week after Mark Woolley passed away. The place was, you know, it was crazy. And I'll never forget it. In 2003, we did our first experience in NASCAR wheel racing, driving for Janice and Mike Bola to a top 10 finish in six starts. It was a memorable and a passion for the sport. We reunited in new way. Before the 2004, we decided to take on our crew on the road and compete in the NASCAR Wheel Modified Tour using a car owned by Joe Gray. Important, improved a difficult transition, but worth having have ever come easy, of course. And a serious highlight came at Seacon when on July 31st, during the Coca-Cola 150, Dick ran as high as second and ultimately finished third overall. We modified racing, taking in a few top 10 finishes, continually improving our point standings year after year. In 2006, at the close of the season, Dick was presented with the Wheelman Modified Tour Driver Achievement Award in 2007. Dick's now would retire from racing and taking time for himself and his family. Highlights from our last season together included Wheelman made him an American 300 in Martinsville, and his final race at Thompson. Of course, the retirement hasn't kept him from the track. Dick climbed behind the wheel a few times, driving for Lenny Ellis and some others. Always making an impression, showing what he had. While my years with Dick were many, I'm not the only car owner who had the pleasure of racing with him. Some of them are here today. Throughout his career, he has been for many owners, including Harry Taylor, Danny Fornia, Jimmy McLeod, Sam Medeiros, Frank Procopio, Bill Ambrosio, Dan Indruck, John McCann, Len Ellis, Greg Paquin, Wayne Dowling, and Joe Viveras. In addition to many of these, I would be remiss if I did not mention those in the garage and on pit road throughout his career. Dick always had the honor of a smart, hardworking crew, and many who are here with us tonight. to those who were at the garage on the track weekly, and those that helped us when we needed an extra hand. Thank you. And of course, so what happened? Oh boy. Okay, so on behalf of the car owners and crew chiefs, crews, and spectators of New England who watch the race week with the decades, it's taken my honor to congratulate you on your accomplishment and rewarding career. Welcome to the New England Racing Hall of Fame.
This might almost be a mimic, unfortunately. Welcome, everyone. Need glasses. To stand before you, a humble man, was truly honored to be mentioned with so many of my childhood racing heroes that have been inducted before me. Upon receiving the call that I was inducted into the Hall of Fame, into the Hare Hall of Fame, I was overcome with emotions. Honestly, I still can't believe it. I truly consider myself blessed. George Summers, Leo Clary, Ronnie Bouchard, George Savory, and my friend Bugsy Stevens are all racers that I looked up. I am also honored to be inducted with five amazing professionals today with the class of 2022. Back in 1972, as a 15-year-old, I built my very first race car to run in the Roadrunner division at Lakeville Speedway. I took a hammer to the roll cage to check to see how strong it was and fell apart. I knew right away I couldn't do this racing thing on my own. It would take me 4 years before I'd take my first checkered flag at Seekonk Speedway in a car owned by Jim McLeod and Sam Medeiros. It was in 1982 that we started to have some success, when in the Bandit Series, as well as in the New England Mini Modified Association Championships, in a car owned and wrenched by Dan Forney, along with the help of Tim Wainwright, John McKenna, and the assistants, believe it or not, Lenny Bowler, designed race car. That didn't hurt either. In 1984, I was blessed to drive Frank Bacopio in a beautiful super fast mini modified built by Rolly Lindblad and crew chief by Jimmy Mullins. This car was way ahead of its time, winning championships at Westboro and Seekonk Speedway. It was in 1987 that I teamed up with Bobby Jr. Caton and the J&R Precast team to go pro stock racing. Thanks to Jr. and the amazing race crew, led by Dave Phillips, we were able to take home the 1996 Pro Stock Championship at Thompson International Speedway. In 2002, Jr. teamed up with the 46th Joe Viveras Insurance Racing Team, which led to back-to-back championships at Seekonk Speedway in 2002 and 2003. In 2003, we decided to go modify tour racing. We didn't have quite the success we wanted, but we definitely learned a lot. My retirement in 2008 was short-lived, when in 2010, longtime competitor and friend Lenny Ellis asked me to drive his 19-year-old pro stock, called it the Old Girl, at Seekonk Speedway. We won a handful of races, but more importantly, we had so much fun. I was honestly able to drive a handful of modified races for Bob Hussey during that same time. After 45 years of racing, I finally hung my helmet up in 2017. Looking back, what a ride it's been. When I say we, I mean we. Without so many amazing car owners, sponsors, crew members over the past 45 years, I personally would have not taken one checkered flag on my own. Never mind a single championship. I consider myself the luckiest guy on earth to be able to do something I love for so many years. Along with the following individuals and supporters, I would not be here. So thank you to the entire Caton family and the number one racing team. Matt Chase had a lot to do with the 46 racing team. Len Ellis and family and the number 41 racing team. Barry Estrella and the Estrella family. Brad Collin, Dave Bolter, Deb Bolter, Bob Nicholson, Kim, my sweetheart, my loving wife, my best friend, biggest supporter. Ashley Caton is my special little fan. In closing, I would be remiss if I didn't mention my mom, Ma Hooley. Love you and miss you. I know she's proud. And thank you for your time. Enjoying the rest of the banquet.
Now, a production like this doesn't go without a lot of people behind the scenes. And this time, we'd like to thank one of the major productions behind us that get us to this point. Would April Mae Preston please stand up so that we can honor her and recognize her for the job that she does. And she stepped outside. Well, let's get her. There she is. Back. So we'd like to thank April for all she does on the near banquet each and every year. Our next inductee has driven to wins at the New London Waterford Speed Bowl at Stafford. He's a fabricator, but mostly I know him over the last couple of years as a mentor. A mentor to a young lady in Melania Shalosky, who's gone on to become, at her young age, the winningest female driver in Speed Bowl history. Our next inductee, a veteran of the auto racing scene in New England, please welcome Mr. Pete Vanderveer.
Thank you, Dave, and good afternoon. This is one heck of a party. I always said racing people have a good time, so give yourself a round of applause for a nice day. I'm mad at you, Matt. You stole my joke. I was going to come up with that joke, but I ate the chicken, so maybe I can be up here for a while. As the motorsports writer at the Norwich Bulletin for many years and for Trackside Magazine, I had the pleasure of covering so many races at the Waterford Speed Bowl. And for any of you that have driven there or for any of you that have competed there, it's a tight little place. Not much room, a lot of bumping, a lot of banging. Crazy things happen. I mean, I remember one night when the state police showed up and hauled about five guys out of the pits. Gee, a fight broke out. How unusual was that? But through all this chaos and some pretty rough times, our next inductee, Phil Rondo, seemed to be a calm individual. Very seldom that I ever see Phil. Only one time that I see Phil get excited. And I would have gotten excited too if I lost the championship because somebody lost a videotape. But and he was, as a writer, you always hope, and I found out over the years that drivers and mechanics were really good to talk to. Although sometimes you'd have an occasion where, especially at Waterford, somebody would come up to you screaming and venting and wanting to, you know, use every expletive in the book. Phil wasn't like that. Phil was quiet, calm, right, got to the point, and I always loved your laugh. Your laugh was just absolutely infectious. That's my side of the story. I'll tell you a little bit about Phil. Some of you might see the irony in the fact that our next inductee, Phil Rondo, grew up on a farm in the Baltic section in the Connecticut town of Spring. Some of you might not. If you're looking for this rural town on a map, you first need to locate Norwich and move a bit north. The distinction here is Rondo joins a group of former Hall of Famers who also grew up on farms. The late Richie Evans, Billy Wimble, and Chick Stockwell. Both Evans and Wimble's racing careers involved miles of travel in search of national championships. Like Stockwell, Phil pretty much stayed home, with the exception of a two-year period when he teamed with Dave Morgenstern and ran the Hooters Pro Cup Series in 2001 and 2002. Most of his racing was done in his home state. More on the Hooters Cup Pro Cup experience will come later. You would expect a teenager with farming roots to be independent, used to long hours, and good with machinery. All three of these attributes can be found in Phil's DNA. He found himself heading off to the nearby Waterford Speed Bowl along with his friend, Tom Goudreau, to work on Tom's father, Al's Modified, driven by Dick Dunn. It was just the beginning. By late 1982, Phil purchased his first race car from Arnie Williams and ran the season's ending race. Arnie Williams and another close friend, Brian McCarthy, knew that Rhonda was behind the wheel. An inauspicious start, for sure. It didn't take that long before the Rhonda name became associated with success. Phil hit the Speed Bowls racing surface at a time of transformation. Big block modifieds were being phased out for the weekly programs, and they were being replaced by stock modifieds, SKs, and an assortment of full fender divisions. On a usual Saturday night, you could find Farmer Phil competing against Flying Brian McCarthy, along with Tom Fox, CJ Fry, Jay Stewart, and a group of others. The division truly had strength in numbers, but was making victories hard to come by. Only after a few wins in 1983 in the then Street Stock division, it would later have two other names, the Strictly Stock and eventually Late Models, and a sprinkling more in 1984, Rondo's career took off in 1985 and kept ascending. He finished with six track championships at Waterford, added three more at Stafford Motor Speedway, and another at Thompson International Speedway. His 107 Waterford wins are second best all time, only recently surpassed in that total by Keith Rocco. He's the only driver in Speed Bowl history to record 100 wins in a single season. Phil first set his sights on Connecticut's other two ovals in 1986. At the season's end, he had a track championship there in the late model division and will add two more. Management at Stafford, Thompson, and Waterford joined forces in 1987, and the Tri-Track Series was born. Phil won the championship, competing in over 60 races, and when the series was reduced to races the following year at Stafford and Waterford only, he again was the top driver. It took a 24/7 mentality to handle the schedule, Rhonda said. I used almost all of my spare time to keep the cars prepared and race ready. Perhaps the highlight in his 152-win career came at Pocono International Speedway in 1989 at the Race of Champions. A 50-lap street stock event brought out the best drivers in the Northeast. Rhonda dominated, leading 49 of those 50 laps. One of the prizes was a case of beer being awarded to each lap led by a driver. Rhonda and his crew took home 49 cases. It was Coors Gold, Phil remembered. Funny thing, I wasn't a drinker. Still, I had one in my hand in victory lane. Teaming with Morgenstein, Phil took his shot at full-time tour racing beginning in 2001. A 13-race schedule took the team from Canada to Florida. It started with a third-place finish in the Thompson Speedway event and bolstered Rondo's confidence. It ended a year later. Between Rondo and Morgenstern, they spent close to $200,000 and made back only $80,000. We sought sponsors and even hired a firm to help us, Rondo said. We came up empty. He returned to the local scene, finishing out as an active driver in 2009 before turning to work with others. Phil is currently vice president of the Tri-State Kart Club located in Pomfret, Connecticut, where his son Anthony drives. He's also been involved, as mentioned before, in Bandolero racing. So I've never walked away from the sport, he says. Can't seem to do it. Some people have blood in their veins. I think mine are filled with motor oil. What has made Phil Rondo so good? There might be a few answers. Consistency, being smooth, always under control, the right mental approach. Fellow competitor Tom Fox, a multi-time champion himself, believes that Phil, through a hands-on approach, always had an innate ability to make a car go fast. He was one of the best, Fox said. Could do it all. We used to switch cars at times. He always made my cars quicker. I get in his, and they feel and drive differently. It was unique. From the farm to the racetrack to victory lane and now to induction into the 2022 near New England Auto Racing Hall of Fame, let's walk him to the podium, Mr. Phil Rondo.
Not good at this stuff. Never was. Didn't like speaking in front of everybody when we won or anything like this. First of all, I'd like to thank the New England Racers Hall of Fame for nominating me. It's a tremendous honor to be inducted into this with all the Hall of Famers that are here, past and present. I'd like to thank my family, my mother, brother Al, John, Connie, my daughter Emily, it's her birthday today, happy birthday. Anthony, my uncle Jasper, my cousin Brian. Without all these people, what I have done would not have happened. My brothers, Tony Mayers, and everybody else, this was not possible. It's like a 24/7, everybody, no matter when it was, working on the cars or whatever it was, these people were around helping all the time. And as everybody knows here, you cannot do it by yourself. There's so many people I have to thank. I know there's going to be people that I forget, so thank you to them. Bob Sweeney, Howie Blackburn, put me in a car that Brian McCarthy was driving. I drove for them. Penny Oshesky at H&H Auto Machine helped me with motors and all that stuff. Like I said, Tony and Carol, Dave Morgenstein, and Matt. Matt was a terrific spotter. He knew where we had to go before it happened on the racetrack. It was like he was driving the car, and I was just the robot turning the wheel. Renee Dugas, the photographer at Waterford, Steve Schaefer, Steve Radway, Snap-on Tools. He was a sponsor for many years. Rich Silvestri for putting me in the SK and the Tour car. That was amazing. We were at Loudoun before the stands were built, practicing with cars. We went up there with windows all the way around on the Tour car, and the things basically sucked. They wouldn't get out of their own way. I remember Reggie Ruggiero taking out the windows and going out there and blistering the racetrack. And they told us, well, we can't have you guys go faster than the cup cars. So they put restrictors on us. It was insane. Pete Olson, Frank Barbonis, Wayne Burroughs, Ronnie Boyle, Gary Merchant, Mikey Dumas, Rico Bozzini, Warren Schipoleski, another gentleman that did lettering on our cars, Alan B. Cool, God rest his soul. I got a little story to tell about this one. Renee Dugas took a picture of me after winning the heat, and it was an up-close picture of the car. And it had the number in it and everything. And I got a phone call from Mr. Cardaway from the Waterford Speedball. He says, Phil, we have a problem. I said, what's that? I said, George, I says, you know, what's going on? He says, did you know there's a naked lady in your picture, in your number? And I'm like, excuse me? I turned around, hung up the phone with him, called Alan, and Alan said, well, I figured it'd take a little while for him to do it, but not 10 races. So he had to come over and re-airbrush the numbers, so there wasn't naked women in my numbers. Fitz Machine, Jannetty Trucking, Steve Simkowski, the Burt family. They took Teddy out of the car and put me in the car. I thought that was a really big step that I took driving for somebody else, because usually I drove most of the time all my own stuff for building everything. The Shalosky family, Melania, you're great. You're super. Waterford Speedball, Stafford Thompson. It's been a privilege to have raced for over 30 years in many different divisions, including street stocks, late models, SKs, tour type modifieds, pro stocks, Busch North, the Hooters Cup, all over New England and all over the country. It's definitely a privilege to be inducted with all the great Hall of Famers like Teddy Christopher, Bob Potter, Reggie Ruggiero, Mike Stefanik. I raced with all these guys. It's definitely an honor and a privilege. And thank you.
Now, there are just some things that fit like a glove, like the name Store and the name of Midgets. Our next presenter is in that category also. Not only is he a voice at the New Hampshire Motor Speedway, but he has been the longtime voice of the NEMA Midgets. It's been my privilege to work with him at the Thompson Speedway and work with him when the NEMA Midgets come to the Speed Bowl. Please welcome to the podium, Mr. Pete Falcone.
Thank you, Dave. It's a pleasure to be here amongst all the wonderful people, and a special congratulations to all the inductees. If you know Russ Storr from racing or as a friend, you know he's a man of few words. Tell me about it. I've had to interview him in Victory Lane more than a few times, and it was like pulling teeth. But he doesn't have much to say, but when it comes to racing, he does his talking with his right foot. There's never been a more unassuming guy that has a precise and flat-out personality behind the wheel of a race car. If it weren't so, he wouldn't be in NEMA history books with achievements like number 4 on the all-time winner list with 49 victories and scores of podium finishes, 17 seasons with victories, including 10 seasons in a row as a winner, and 6-time champion in some of NEMA's most competitive years. Let's go back to where it all started. Like so many of us in this room today, Russ Storr grew up around racing. In particular, open wheel, open cockpit, not for the faint of heart, midget racing. In his earliest years, he watched his father, the late Paul Storr, work on those cars and drive them competitively all over the Northeast. Working on the cars was interesting and fun, but Russ always wanted to drive, and so did his brother Greg, as a matter of fact. And it's obvious that Paul taught them well. 60 NEMA features between Russ and Greg, and they went on to teach their own kids how to win. Third-generation racers like Bethany Storr and Avery Storr are in the history books, too. But Russ finally got his chance to drive, and by today's standards, a little later in life. Russ was in his 20s. Of course, today we have kids starting in NEMA years before they're even eligible for a driver's license. Russ was lucky because he teamed up with his father and a guy that knew a lot about building and maintaining winning race cars, Bruce Bean. Russ started in that car, a car that Bruce and Paul had built, a real homemade version. In fact, eventually it was powered by one of the first Cosworth engines in the club. It took a minute, but Russ got his first win in 1987 at the Star Speedway. Russ even got the chance to race against his father and eventually his brother. Russ had found the right combination driving for Bruce. He won a lot of races. In fact, Russ won his first championship in 1990. When he won another championship in 97, Bruce finally won the Owners' Championship that year, too. Bruce retired after that championship, and Russ ran the car for a couple of years after that. But a pivotal point in Russ's career came when he got hired to drive for the multi-time champion car owner Gene Angelillo. When the great Drew Fenoro left the ride in Dumo's Desire number 45, Russ was right on the phone to Gene to offer his services. And it was a decision that led to multiple wins and 3 championships in a row, 2000, 2001, and 2002. They were the class of NEMA, kings of the sport those years. Then Russ made a difficult decision to leave Gene in order to build up his successful car business with his brother Greg in Bridgewater, Massachusetts, and devote more time to his family at home. Joey Payne took the seat in Angelillo's number 45, and gave Gene another championship in 2003. When Payne left the ride in 2008, Gene went back to Russ, and Russ hadn't lost a step, winning more races in that famous number 45, but there was more disappointment to deal with. 2 years later, Gene passed away, but Gene's daughter, Laura, wanted to keep the team going and asked Russ to stay on. It was a wise decision, as they won one more championship in 2010, no doubt with some guidance from Gene up above. When the 45 team retired from competition, Russ did not. He drove for Ed Breaux for a couple of seasons and other sporadic rides until he finally hung up the helmet in 2015. But Russ Storr's success in racing didn't end there, and it goes beyond his time behind the wheel. He was president of NEMA in 2016. Rumor has it he may go back to that seat in 2023, I'm hearing. And over the years, he worked on a car campaign by his brother Greg. And Rusk and his son Avery started midget racing. As they say, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, and that's very evident with the success that Avery's had. Avery won his very first race at the Waterford Speed Bowl in his rookie year of 2014. Since then, he was crowned the NEMA champion in 2019, and again champion this year, 2022, after a dominating five-win season in NEMA, and even more wins for him doing double duty in the NEMA Light Division. I asked Russ if he felt Avery's success came from watching him win so many races over the years and coaching from him and Avery's grandfather, Paul. Russ said that Avery's interest in driving may have come from watching him, as it had for Russ watching his father. But the success Avery's having comes from a style of his own. Russ says that Avery's driving skills are all from his own talent, and Russ couldn't be more proud. Well, the entire Northeastern Midget Association and New England Racing Fraternity is very proud of Russ Storr today, the multi-time midget champion, club president, successful businessman, mentor and friend to many, is going into the New England Auto Racing Hall of Fame. Ladies and gentlemen, the great Russ Storr.
I don't know if I'm supposed to follow that, but I'm going to give it a shot. I'd like to thank the NEMA, and I'd like to thank the committee for putting me forward and putting me in this class this year. As Pete said, my father started us off in this game, and I was very fortunate when the car owner that he used to drive for had stepped away for a while. Wanted to get back into the sport. My father was driving for Ed Suzuki at the time, and he told Bruce Bean to give Russ a shot, which he did. And I was very fortunate that Bruce had a homemade car in the beginning, but he had the means to notice a talented young driver, and he bought him a brand new car 2 years after that, and we started winning right away with it. I was also very fortunate to have Richard Nathan as my original crew chief, who's sitting at the table over there now. He was Bobby White's crew chief, and he guided him to some success as well. The other thing I'd like to say is, always growing up, there was midgets in my father's and my mother's garage. There was people over all the time. And not people that would ever make it to the Hall of Fame, just the backbone of the organization. My father passed about a month ago, and it's my honor to remember those people that my father helped support this club for as many years as he did, and they still are. And it's that those memories that I'm going to take with me to the Hall, and it's just a wonderful experience. And additionally, as Pete touched on, I was president of the club for a year, and I'm probably going to be going back. But, you know, it was amazing to me. There was a point in time a couple of years ago that I asked Cindy Tibbetts if I could come into the scoring tower and just see what goes on. And to watch Pete in action, Cindy in action, and look at all the people that it takes to run an organization, how smoothly and seamlessly they do the job for very little financial gain, it's an amazing thing to be a part of. That's all I have to say. Thank you all very much.
As we have heard today, riders play a huge part in documenting our sport. Pete Zanardi, Pete Vandeveer, our next in Hall of Fame presenter, enters that class also. He's won the Mitchell Ratter Award here with us at NEAR. Please welcome to the podium, Mr. Justin St. Louis.
How are we doing, everybody? I have something here prepared, but first I want to start off by saying thank you to the Bouchards. That award today for Johnny Margiello is the coolest damn thing that this club has done in years. So, hats off. This past Monday marked the anniversary of the passing of Richie Evans, and our friend Bonesy made a post on Facebook recalling Richie's 9 national championships and evoking memories of, in his words, a massive talent. I grew up on pavement, so there were only a handful of dirt names that I knew as a kid, but one of them was Kenny Tremont Jr. He won everywhere, every weekend, forever, and it was at the top level of modified against Jack Johnson, CeeDee Colville. I could go on and on. When I finally started following Dirt, he was the first guy that I started paying attention to. Raise your hands in this room. I know there's a lot of asphalt people, but how many of you have seen Kenny Tremont wheel car? And you'll agree, he is a massive talent. It's the kind of talent that has earned him 53 championships and 392 and counting feature wins over a 44-year career. Because this is the New England Auto Racing Hall of Fame, though, and because his mail arrives in New York State, we have to ignore 300 of those wins today and 39 of those championships because they happened at Lebanon Valley or Albany, Saratoga, or Volusia, or up in Quebec, or anywhere else. So the Syracuse Mile as well. But that still leaves 92 wins and 14 championships that I can talk about today. Accolades certainly worthy of induction into this great fraternity. You all know in this room what the number 61 means, right? You all know what DPW Orange is, right? 115, red, white, and black. Iconic. It can only mean one thing. It's Kenny. I had so many fond memories of that 115. Week after endless week, charging from 18th or 21st through the field and taking the win. Maybe sometimes by halfway he was leading. Maybe it was the last corner of the last lap, but it happened all the time. It happened on dirt, it happened on asphalt. It happened in big blocks, in small blocks, in sportsman cars. It happened so regularly that I had to scratch my head every week to figure out a new headline because that got pretty tough to say, Tremont wins again. But I must stress that it was never boring. Kenny Tremont can drive a car. Oh man, can he ever. But what's more, he simply outbrains them. He reads the field, he studies the track surface, he makes his adjustments, he plans his moves, he goes where they aim. And by the end of it, he's bringing them all to school. Small wonder then that he is a real-life college professor. That most recent New England win, that 92nd win that counts today, happened about 8 weeks ago on Labor Day, and it just might be my favorite Kenny Tremont win of all, and I think it might be one of his too. It happened at my favorite place on earth, Devil's Bowl Speedway, and the track was hosting the annual Vermont 200. It's the richest race in the world for dirt, sports, and modified cars, paying $10,000 to win, $325 to start, and about $700 or $7,000 in lap leader money. It's the race that off all the promoters who pay $400 to win in the sportsman every week. There were 87 cars in the pits trying to qualify that day, which means that yet again it was the biggest race in New England. And one of those 87 cars had a familiar driver with Mr. Tremont, but the car was not the 115 that we were all used to. It was instead a jet black car with a bright orange 24 on the door. It was the only car built by Pete Chukda in the PMC garage that had qualified for the field. And it wasn't new. In fact, it hadn't raced at all in 2022. What's more, it was the only car running on the antiquated torsion bars, as all those other 86 cars were on the newfangled coilover stuff. Chasing their tails, I might add. The story writes itself, right? He started 20th, he read the field. He stayed away from the drama up front, and for most of the night, he wasn't even a contender, because that was the plan. Let them all use up the coilover stuff. Outbrain them. And it worked. After riding and studying for 175 laps, he took the opening that he knew was coming, and with 25 to go, he drove that little bar car away to the win. Richie Evans was a 9-time national champion, but as Bonesy reminded us, he was also a 9-time most popular driver. Most dominant drivers get booed after a while, but Richie was a man of the people. Same goes for Kenny Tremont Jr. That Vermont 200 win was his 90th at Devil's Bowl, number one all time, and not even within reach of second place. He has won 10 track championships, 10 of them, at Devil's Bowl Speedway alone. Yet, when he climbed out of John St. Germain's car in Victory Lane, the only thing that he heard was a chorus of cheers and adulation. I may not have known Richie Evans, but I do know Ken Tremont Jr. Like Richie, he is a class act, a driver who has time for every kid, every adult, every fan. He is a driver who a promoter can call upon to make a public appearance at a moment's notice, and he'll do it because he knows that it's good for the sport. He is a driver who will get behind a rule change because it helps the little guy, even if it slows his own program down. He might not brag about it openly either, but I can tell you that he's also a bit of a nerd when it comes to this kind of stuff. He likes records. He likes Hall of Fame ceremonies. He likes getting together and swapping stories. I almost said shooting. He's excited about the history of this sport.
He knows how many wins Richie had. He knows how many wins Teddy had, and Bugsy, and Bobby Dragon, and Noki Fornaro, and Bentley. I'm sure he knows how many wins Brett Hearn has, too. But he's excited that his records stack up against theirs. And I've talked about him with this stuff. I know that he feels the history, and I know that today means a lot to him. He's a little bit shy about it, about honoring himself, but I know that he is very proud to be in this room today, and he and his family should be. Today does mean a great deal to him. It means a great deal to me, and he has earned this honor as a Hall of Famer beside his father, Ken Senior, who we put in a few years ago. A first ballot slam dunk in his first year of eligibility at age 60 is my great privilege to induct into the New England Auto Racing Hall of Fame the West Sand Lake Slingshot, Kenny Tremont Jr.
Justin, I don't know if I was ever that good. You gave me quite a reputation to live up to, but thank you.
Never let the truth get in the way of a good story.
But I appreciate Neer and all the committee for nominating me and then eventually electing me to this. I think of all the people that are in this Hall of Fame, especially guys like Eddie Klemke, Bugsy Stevens. I can't even believe I'm even in the same club, but it's really pretty neat. I do appreciate it. Thank you very much. So getting ready to do this, and I was thinking, boy, I gotta come up with a speech that sounds somewhat intelligent. So I went to my good friend Google and figured out maybe I can they can help me organize this speech. And I read a little story on a person, Joe Torre, New York Yankees. And he was saying in there when he got ready to do his Hall of Fame speech, it was all about the people. So the same thing goes for me, too. It was all about the people throughout my whole career. So I just got a few key people. I won't keep you, for a half hour or anything. But, throughout my whole life, my whole career, that stuck out. So number one would be my grandparents, Ken and Dorothy Tremont. And I'll give you a little story. They had a lumberyard hardware store. And they used to let me use their haul truck to go to Devil's Bowl Speedway back in the late 70s. So this was a fairly new lumber truck, flatbed, that they used to let me use. I was 17 at the time. And I didn't think much of it at the time, but they let me take this truck. And we'd go all the way to Devil's Bowl. I didn't have any ramps to unload it. Thankfully, Devil's Bowl had the ramp in the back that's gone now. So we used to back up there, me and a couple of my high school buddies, unload the car, race the car, load it back up. And then, obviously go home after that. Thinking about this, we come home and we had a low ramp in my grandparents' front yard. So 1, 2, 3 o'clock in the morning, we'd be backing up to the loading dock. And my grandparents had a 1953 Golden Jubilee tractor. I would fire the tractor up, back up to the car, pull it off with a chain, all in my grandparents' yard. I know I had to wake them up because the house is right there. But being 17, never thought much of it. So then, as I got older and had my own kids, I got thinking to myself, would I let my 17-year-old kid do that? And the answer would be no. So I got to thank my grandparents, and they must have trusted me. But, that was one of the first big shots in the arm that would help me, actually go to Devil's Bowl and Lebanon Valley. Also need to thank my sister Kim, who's been, obviously with us, all these years too as well. Doing all the bookwork, keeping track of, entry fees, paying bills. She would be the person that would come to me and say, did you buy $3,000 worth of tires? And I could say, yeah. Well, I don't know how we're gonna pay for this. And I said, well, we'll figure it out. But thankfully for Kim, she's been through there through thick and thin, taking care of t-shirt sales and trying to pay the bills and just keep everything from getting too far out of hand. Also my family too, my kids, Ryan, Mason, his wife, Joanna, Kenny, Kale, Montgomery, Samantha, they've been through thick and thin, and they still enjoy the races and going to the races, so I'm appreciative of that, and they're supportive. Also, my wife, Kathy, who, again, puts up with, all the late hours, are we going to have dinner, aren't we going to have dinner? We had a nice argument on the way over about her navigational skills, and she told me where to stick my phone. And it was like a 5-minute argument. We got over it just like we always do. But I appreciate everything. She's still drinking the Kool-Aid, still loves me for some strange reason. But thanks for hanging in there. I appreciate that. And probably the number one person is my dad. Through all the, he's had a race car since like about 1961, starting at Lebanon Valley. And he always seems to be the common guiding, overseer of everything. Doesn't let anything get too far out of hand. So I appreciate him. I mean, there's been many times when I thought, maybe this racing game is too tough. It takes too much work, too much money, too much time. He would be the guy that would calm everything down and, be the guy that would keep the organization going. I know I personally, if I was alone, I would have quit without his help. I always think, sometimes I get a chance to watch that Yankee center stage with Michael Kay, and at the end of the interview with the sports star, he always says, to the person that he's interviewing, if you were stuck in a foxhole, who would you want to be in there with you? And my answer would be my dad. So maybe Clint Eastwood, too. That would help. So thanks to my family, obviously. And I just wanted to mention, a couple of the key sponsors that I've had through the years, and they always seem to come along right at the right time when we're down on our luck and maybe one sponsor is leaving. And it always seemed to work out through the years, but my uncle Dennis Tremont Sr. Had a construction company that helped me out when I was first starting. Wunderlich Sand and Gravel, Mats and Overhead Doors, Fane Concrete, Reifenberg Construction were kind of the major sponsors that helped us out through the years. My good friend Brian Bedell, who was also a little bit of a nerd, he loves the history. He had a speed shop, Boomer's Performance, so he was a help through the years, and we're always comparing stats, and if you think I like stats, he's the guy for that. And then also, too, again, it's all about the people. I had a lot of help through the years. I mean, a tremendous lot of help. I can remember people when I was a kid, and we had the race car in the cellar, and I'll tell you one quick story. You bent the frame one night, and I was just a kid. I wasn't a part of the crew fixing anything. And me and my two sisters were watching TV upstairs, and then all of a sudden I could feel the floor where we're sitting watching TV move, and the TV moving to the side. And my mother running downstairs, Ken, what's the matter? Well, they were straightening the frame out, but they braced the frame against the floorboard of the house, and it took the house a little bit out of level, not bad. So, a lot of stories like that, too, as well. But a couple key people, and people have come and gone. They've worked with us for 10 years, going away for 10, come back another 10, raised families. I mean, it's amazing. We could write a whole book on the people that have helped us through the years. But Gene Rescott would be a guy that was a real spark plug, a lot of energy, did a lot of work for us through the years. Ray Deemer, Mike Sullivan, Lance Harding, Scott Forster, a lot of guys, through the years. And there's probably been 50 to 100 people through the shop. So without all those people, without my family, obviously, I wouldn't be here tonight. And I would like to say, just in closing, that if you've never been to Devil's Bowl, you've got to take a minute to go there. Mike, you're in the back there, maybe just wave. But Mike has done a great job with Devil's Bowl. He's put a lot of money in it and a lot of effort. And him and his wife, Elaine, are doing a great job. I just wanted to recognize Mike and say, I really appreciate, I've gone to Devil's Bowl since probably as a kid, in the mid-1960s. It opened 67, so I'm sure I was there with my mother sitting in the grandstands at one point. But you're doing a good job. Keep it up. Justin has worked with Mike through the years quite a bit, and has done a good job too as well. So thanks to Nira, and I really appreciate this. This is one of my, my highlights through the years. Thank you very much.
As smoothly as he drove into the wind, Kenny Tremont drives into the Hall of Fame. Now, before I call up all our award winners and our Hall of Fame winners for their pictures, I just ask that you take a glass. As we've heard earlier today with Johnny Morgillo, the Who song, "The Kids Are All Right," is certainly true. To all the drivers honing their skills at Palm Creek, Stafford's Wild Thing Karts, or my old home track, Silver City in Meriden, Connecticut, we eagerly await the day that you thrill us. To the stars of today, open wheel, full fender, on dirt or asphalt, we look forward to making the fans rise from their seats and the announcers' voices go up a few octaves in describing their actions. And finally, to the heroes of yesteryear who are here with us today, and those yet to be inducted, and those watching above, racing at a track that someday we all hope to visit. Your tales will never be forgotten. Your deeds will live on forever. Thank you to you all, and cheers.